Hello guys, welcome to another video in the series of coding. Today we are going to do the problem which is called cycle in directed graph. So you have to detect whether a directed graph has cycle or not, and you are given edges in the graph. So you have to detect whether it contains a cycle or not and return 1 if cycle is present, else return 0. So there are basically two algorithms that are used for detecting a cycle in our directed graph, and the two algorithms are simply the algorithms that we always use, which are DFS and BFS based. Okay, so let us see how to detect cycles using both the algorithms. So the BFS algorithm also has a new name, it's called Kahn's algorithm. Okay, and we'll modify the BFS algorithm a little bit to make it the Kahn's algorithm, and it will be able to detect cycle in a directed graph. Okay. So first let's see the simple one. The simple one is DFS, right? Let's see how to detect cycle using a DFS. So let's take an example. Suppose you have something like this. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. Now, is this a cycle? Does this graph have a cycle? No, this is not a cycle, right? Because what is a cycle? What will be a cycle? 1, 2, 3, 4. This will be a cycle. If you can start from 1, follow the path and come back to 1 again. Okay. Start from 1, follow the path and come back to 1 again, then it is a cycle, right? This is not a cycle, this is a cycle, because in this, if you start from 1, you can reach up to 4, but from 4 you cannot come back like this. You cannot come back to 1, right? Because this is not this way. If it had been this and this, then there'll be a cycle. Okay, so this distinction is very important, because see, we'll have to modify the DFS algorithm also a little bit to detect cycle in a directed graph. First, let's quickly revise how to detect cycle in an undirected graph. Okay, so let's say you have an undirected graph. What did we do to detect cycle in that? Suppose something like this, and this is a cyclic graph. Now, suppose you want to detect cycle in this, right? So then, and the graph is undirected. Then you can apply both BFS and DFS to detect the cycle. If you are applying, for example, let's say DFS, so what will you do? You will just keep a visited array, and apart from visited array, you will also keep track of parent. Okay, that's it. So let's see. So for 1, the parent is -1. Okay, -1 is the parent for 1, and we will just keep track of visited array. Okay. So right now, let's say we are starting from 1. We have visited 1. Okay, now let us go to 2. Okay. So now for 2, the parent is 1, okay, and since 1 is the parent, 1 is already, 1 is supposed to be visited. It's okay, 1 is visited, but if some other node apart from its parent is visited, then that is unusual and there is a cycle. Okay, that is the algorithm. So 1 is its parent and 1 is visited, so nothing unusual, because parent is supposed to be visited, you came from parent only. Okay, so this is fine. So now we'll mark it also as visited. Okay, so I'll write true. You can write 1 or 0, whatever, or you can use true false, you can use a boolean or integer array, that's not important. Okay, so let's say we visited. Now let's call 3. Okay, now we'll make the call for 3. So now for 3, the parent is 2. Okay, for 3 the parent is 2. So when 3 is seeing who all are visited, who all of my neighbors are visited, 3 will first check 2. But 2 was its parent, so it's supposed to be visited. It is fine. But what if there is 4? Okay, so 4 is also the neighbor, so we will mark 4 as true. Okay, and now for 4 the parent is 3. Now let us call the algorithm, and 3 is also visited. Okay, 3 is visited, 4 is visited, and for 4 the parent is 3. Now what 4 will do? 4 will also try to call its neighbors. When 4 calls 3, nothing is unusual, because 3 is the parent and that is visited, that is supposed to happen. But when 4 tries to see this node, okay, 4 tries to see 1, how come 1 is visited? It didn't call 1, right? It didn't call 1, but 1 was visited by someone else before. So how come 1 is visited? 1 is supposed to be called by 4, but 1 is already visited. So that means there is a cycle, right? This was a simple algorithm for detecting cycle in an undirected graph. Now you can't use the simple algorithm, because the problem is the simple algorithm will detect cycle here also, because it will think of it like this and it will detect cycle here also. Okay, so let us apply the same algorithm here. Let's say our graph is directional. Now let's simply give it directions. Okay, and let's apply the same algorithm. So let us apply the same algorithm by considering it, okay, as a directed graph. So now let me try to apply the same algorithm from beginning. You can apply both DFS or BFS. Okay. give the same results only. Let's simply apply the normal algorithm, what we do, right, for a undirected graph. Let's try to see what is the problem in that algorithm. So for one, the parent is minus one, okay, and it's true. Now let us call two, okay, let us call two. For two, the parent is one, okay, and it is supposed to be visited. So it's nothing is unusual. So we can just mark it true and we can go forward. Now for three, the parent is two, okay, so it will mark three as true and it will make a DFS call here. Now for three, what is happening is three will see that there is no children of it, right? Three doesn't have any other children which it needs to call. So what we'll do, we will just go back, okay, we will go back, okay, and then we will go back here also. So we will go back from here. For three, the parent is two, for two, the parent is one, and we will go back. Now when we are going back, one had two children, right? One had two children, two and four. So after these calls have finished, after these both calls have finished, we will come back to this call. Now one is also having four as the child, right? So one will make a call to four, okay, and it will mark it as two and it will say that I am the parent. Now four will make a call to its child, which is three. Okay. Now four will see that three is already visited. Four will see that three is already visited. So according to our simple algorithm, which simply uses only one visited array and parent, okay, to keep a note. In that case, it will think that how come 3 is visited when it is not my parent, okay? 3 is visited and it even I should have visited it first time because I am making the DFS call, but someone else has already visited it, okay? So from here, somebody has visited it and you also visited it from here. So you will think that 3, at the node 3, there is a cycle that is forming. So you will detect cycle in this, but actually there is no cycle. Okay, so the simple algorithm doesn't work. So then which algorithm is going to work? Okay, so to apply the algorithm, we will have to modify this just a little bit. Okay, so what is the modification which we are going to do? Okay, so we are basically going to, apart from visited array, we are also going to keep a track of one extra array. That is it. That is one simple modification which we are going to do. So we have the visited array. We have the visited array. Apart from this, we will also keep an extra array. Okay. We'll also keep an extra array. Now, how is this extra array going to help us? We are going to see. We'll also keep an extra array. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. Now, this will ensure that we don't detect a cycle in such cases. Okay, let us see. Let us see how it's going to ensure. So, initially for 1. Okay, initially we are making a call for 1. And for 1, okay, 1 is going to be true. Okay, 1 is going to be true. Now, we'll also mark it in the extra array, okay. In the extra array also we will make this as 1 and we'll mark it as true. Okay, so now from 1 we will go and make the call to 2. Okay, so 2 is also, okay, now 2 is also visited, so 2 will also be 2, and in extra array also we'll mark it as true. Then from 2 we'll make a call to 3, so we'll mark it in the visited array as well as we'll mark it in the extra array. Okay, so both will be marked as true. Now, this will backtrack because 3 doesn't have any children, right? 3 doesn't have any children. 3 is a single node who has no out degree, okay? It doesn't have to call anyone. So, what we will do, we will backtrack from here. So, I will remove this, I will remove this. While backtracking, what we are going to do, okay, while backtracking, what we are going to do, we are going to remove it from the extra array also. So, we will remove 3, we will remove 2, okay? It is no more true, okay? It is no more true. We will go back. While backtracking, we will not change the visited array, but in extra array, we will mark them as false back again. Okay. So now when you are coming from 1 and you are making a call to 4, you will mark it in the visited array and you will mark it in the extra array. Now 4 will go and see 3. Okay. So in the visited array, even though 3 is true, somebody else has visited it, but 4 is like... It was not visited in this DFS call. It was not visited when this DFS call was taking place, right? So, suppose it had been visited within this DFS call, right? Then there would have been a cycle. But it was not visited during the DFS call currently. So, in the extra array, 3 is false, right? It is false, right? These two numbers are false because they are not true. They are false. So, it will notice that 3 is false. So, there is no cycle. That is a simple algorithm. So there is no cycle in this particular case. Okay. So now we have seen it will work for these cases, but how will it detect cycle? We'll take an example of that. Let's take this particular case and try to understand. Okay. So let me just erase it and we'll take this example so that we will be able to understand it better. So when there is a cycle, we have, for example, cycle like this. Let's take a simple example. Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4. In this case, there's going to be a cycle. So what is our algorithm? We're just modifying the DFS a little bit. We are keeping the visited array as usual, but we are also marking an extra array. That's it. Just simple modification. Okay. So let us start again. Now it is supposed to detect, this algorithm is supposed to detect the cycle, which it will detect. Okay. Let's say 1. We are starting from 1. So we'll mark 1 as true. In the extra array also, we'll mark it as true. Okay. Now let us come back to 2. Let us come to 2, right? We are coming to 2 from 1. So let us mark it in visited array as well as in the extra array. Now let us go to 3. So we'll mark it true in the visited array as well as in the extra array. Okay. Now 3 is also going to make a call to 4. So 3 will make 4 as true, and it will make 4 as true also. Now 4 will make a call to 1. Okay. Now 4 is making a call to 1. It is seeing that 1 is visited as well as in the extra array, it is true. What does this mean? This means during this DFS call only, during this call that was ongoing, 1 was seen somewhere, right? During this DFS call, I came to 4, and from 4, I'm going back to my ancestor. I'm going back to 1, right? I'm going back to 1. So that is why it is a cycle. So it will detect a cycle. That is a simple DFS based algorithm. So let us see the code for that, and then we'll see one algorithm which is called Kahn's algorithm, which is basically a BFS based algorithm that is also used to detect cycles. So let us see first of all DFS based solution. Okay, so let us see. So the DFS based solution is as such. First of all, we are creating the adjacency list because they have given it in the form of edges. So we have to transform it to the adjacency list representation. So we are using vector, simply called it as M. And basically we have the source node which is given, and we have the destination node which is given to us. This is given in the input. So we'll just take that and we'll push it in the adjacency list. So I'm just creating the adjacency list here. Now I'm keeping two arrays as we have discussed, visited as well as one extra array. Okay. So now in this case, and this is a simple algorithm which we apply in DFS, right? If a node is not visited, then we are going to mark it as visited. Okay. And I'm also going to mark extra as true. In this case, this is one extra line that we are adding, and we are going to apply the DFS algorithm. Why is this needed? Because the graph need not be connected, right? Always. For example, you can have graph like this. You can have 1, 3, let's say some other graph, and let's say you can have 2, 6, 7 and something like this. So you can have two different pieces of graphs that are not connected and given to you, right? So you can have a disconnected graph. So it is very important to write this code, right? This is very important because if a graph is disconnected, then you have to write this for loop. Whenever you have not visited it, you should call the DFS algorithm for all the components. Okay, now let us see the DFS based solution to detect the cycle. Okay, so in this case, first of all, whichever is the node which we are starting with, which is the source node which we are starting with, that I'm just taking the neighbors of that, and this can be got using the adjacency list which we created. The name of my adjacency list is M, so I've just written M, and we are getting the adjacency list. Now for all the neighbors in the adjacency list, I'm just visiting it. So the simple algorithm is, if extra of X is also true, right, then I have to return true. That is a cycle. At this case, I catch my cycle, because if extra of X is also true, that means during this DFS call only, somebody else has already visited it. During this DFS call, it is within this DFS call that I made it true. Because once the DFS call ends, I am making it false back. I am making it false. So, but if it still remains true, right? That means during the DFS algorithm when it was running, it is my own ancestor. So I have to return true. There is a cycle. Okay. I am making a connection back to my ancestor. So I have to return true. Now, okay, if this is not true, right? That means if extra is false, okay, then there can be two cases. One, if you have already visited it. If you have already visited it, you can ignore. You cannot do, you should not unnecessarily call it back again. But if you have not visited it, then you apply the simple algorithm, call the DFS back again. Okay. So you mark the visited as true this time, you mark the extra as true during this recursive call, and then you call the DFS algorithm. And if it returns true, it will return true from here. If in case it returns true, it will return true back. Okay. And it should return true back to the main call finally after all these calls are over. Once you have come back from the call, you have to backtrack and you have to mark the extra as false, which we were doing. Okay? And we have to return false. So that is a simple DFS based algorithm that is going to work. So in this case, let me just submit and see. It's taking some time. Yeah, it's fine. Okay, now let us see the Kahn based algorithm. So there is one more algorithm which is again very famous, and it's used to detect cycles in directed graphs. So what is that algorithm? Okay, let us quickly apply the Kahn based algorithm. So okay, let me try to take some better example this time. Let us say we have some graph like this, say one, and then let's say we have two, let's say we have four. Okay, something like this. So in this case, there is a cycle in this graph, and this is the cyclic part. Okay, this is the cyclic part. So what is this algorithm? Basically, it's also used for topological sorting. It's also used for topological sorting, and it can be used to detect cycle. So what is basically topological sorting is, suppose you have nodes, right? And you have to visit them in some particular order. Okay, let's say this is one very common example. If you have courses that you have to complete, let's say you have to complete first year courses first, then only you can go to second year courses, then only you can do third year courses, and then only you can do fourth year courses. There are prerequisites. Unless you pass first year, let's say you're not allowed into second year, and so on. So this is used, that is topological sorting. By order, you are going to go order wise, and then you are going to complete the courses. So this is one famous example. So let us see. So initially, what we are going to do is, we are going to mark all the nodes that have in degree as zero. So what is in degree? So suppose there is a node that is given to you, right? Either it has a connection like this, right? Or it has an outgoing connection. So in this case, what is the in degree? Only one node is coming to it, right? So the in degree for this node is one. Okay, let's take some other example. Let's say we have some node which just has outgoing children, but it doesn't have something like this, but it doesn't have any incoming children. In that case, its in degree is zero. In that case, it's in degree is 0. Okay, let's take some other example. Suppose it has 3 incoming nodes. Then in that case, it's in degree is 3. Okay, so that is what we mean by in degree. So what we are going to do is, whenever the in degree is 0, it is not dependent on anything. There are no incoming nodes. For example, this node is not dependent on anything. It has in degree 0. Okay, what about some other node? What about this node? It has an in degree of 1, right? It has an in degree of 1. What about this node? It also has a lot of in degrees. 1, 2, 3. Okay, it has an in degree of 3. What about this node? It has one incoming node, right? So it has an in degree of 1. What about this node? It has an in degree of 2. It has an in degree of 2. Okay. So what is Kahn based algorithm is, basically we are going to take the nodes that have the in degree 0, and we are going to put them in a queue. It is a BFS based algorithm, so we are going to use queue. Okay. So what we are going to do? We are going to take a queue. Whichever node has in degree 0, because they are not dependent on anything, right? So they are the ones that are going to be first in the order. So you are going to take this node and you are going to put it in the queue. So we put one in the queue. Okay, now we will start our BFS based algorithm. So we will take one, we will extract it from the queue, and what we'll do, we will visit all its children, right? All its children we will visit, and we will make their in degree, we will decrease their in degree, because once you are reducing that dependency. Okay, let's say you finish the task one, or let's say you complete the first year courses, then you can go and complete the next courses. You have at least reduced one level of dependency, right? Suppose three is dependent, three cannot be done. Okay, unless one is finished, three cannot be done unless one is completed, right? Let's say you cannot finish task three unless one is completed. So once you have completed the task one, once we have popped it out, that means now you can do three, right? So you can do three. So you will go and make its in degree zero. You will go to this, you will go and make its in degree one. It was earlier dependent on two nodes, right? It was dependent on two nodes. At least one of them has finished. So you can reduce the in degree and make it one. Okay. And similarly, we'll come to this node also. We'll reduce its in degree and we'll make it in its in degree 2. Now, let us go to the next node. So, what is the next node? Next node which has an in degree 0. So, this node has an in degree 0. So, we will put 3 in the queue. Now, we will pop 3 from the queue. And again, we'll do the same thing, right? So, what are the children of 3? 3 was causing a dependency on 4. So, now we will reduce its dependency by 1. Because we have completed task 3, it gives us a chance that we can go to the next task, right? Okay, so we go to the next task. Okay, now let us finish this. Okay, so now we have popped it out. Now in this case, what will happen is, now in this case, there is cycle, right? There is a cycle. So in this case, what will happen? You will reach such a condition when you cannot make the n degree as zero. You will reach such a condition, and basically you will just be able to process two nodes in this case, right? So you are just able to process the node one, and then you are able to process the node three. But other nodes are dependent on each other because there is a cycle, right? There is a cycle. Suppose there is this cycle, right? There is this cycle. So 2 is dependent on 4. Unless you complete 2, you cannot complete 4. Unless you complete 4, you cannot complete 5. Unless you complete 5, you cannot complete 2. There is a cycle, right? How is it even possible? How can you? You cannot start any task and reach to any final task, right? Because let's say you complete 2. Okay, now what? You can do 4. Okay, you can do 4. Let's say you complete 4. Now what? You can do 5. But now you cannot, like, you cannot do 2. It's a paradox. You cannot do 2 because you couldn't complete 5. For starting 2 itself, you needed to complete 5, right? So you could not have started 2 itself unless you had completed 5. So if there is a cycle, you can never find a ordering, right? They're all dependent on each other. So in this case, you were able to process only 2 nodes. You were able to only process 1 and you were able to process 3, right? You were able to process only 2 nodes. So since you were not able to process all the nodes, you can just keep a count. And if you are not able to process all the nodes, you can say that there is a cycle, return cycle is equal to true. Okay, that is a simple algorithm. Now let us see this on some algorithm where there is no cycle, right? Where there is no cycle, in that case this algorithm is going to work and also detect that there is no cycle. Okay, let us see some example. Let us see a simple example. Let's say we are seeing this. Okay, just taking a simple graph. So we are going to first of all note the n degree. So n degree of 1 is 0, right? There is no incoming node. N degree of 2 is 1. N degree of 3 is 1. Okay, n degree of 4 is 2. Okay, so now let us start by pushing in the queue. So we will push the node which has n degree 0. It is 1. Okay, so we will pop it out. And now what we will do? We will go to its neighbors and we will say that now I have completed task 1. You can do the remaining task. So I will make its n degree 0. So now two nodes have n degree 0. So in this case, you can process 2, you can process 3. So I'll push both. Now I'll pop, let's say the node 2. I'll pop 2. So when I'm popping 2, I will go to the neighbors of 2 and I will make their n degree also. I'll reduce their n degree by 1. So I will reduce its dependency and now its n degree becomes 1. Now I will go to 3 and I will pop 3. I will pop 3 and I will go to its children and I will make its n degree 0. So in this case, now in degree of 4 also becomes 0. So you can take 4 and you can process 4. Now 4 doesn't have any remaining children to be processed. So we have visited. In this case, we visited all the nodes. We processed all the nodes 1, 2, 3, 4. So there is no cycle. So that is a simple algorithm. Okay. So let us see the code of it. Okay. So the code of it is this. And basically, this is just the adjacency list which I am creating. And this is the n degree that I am creating. Initially, n degree of everything, I am simply giving 0. And whenever we see a incoming node, we will increase the n degree. Also, we are having a visited array because we don't want to visit nodes again. Okay. So in this case, now I'm just making the adjacency list. So because we are given in the form of edges, so we have to convert it to the adjacency list. So basically, I'm taking the source node, destination node, and source and destination are just pushed into our adjacency list. Okay. Now I'm increasing the n degree of the destination node because let's say 1 is connected to 2. That means from 1, we are going to 2. So 2 has an incoming node. So the n degree of 2 will increase. Okay. Now let us see the queue. And basically, we are keeping a count. If we are able to process all the nodes, that means there is no cycle. You can return false. But if there is a cycle, then you will not be able to process all the nodes. So your count will never be equal to the number of nodes. Okay. So now let us see the algorithm. So if the n degree is 0, I'm just running a for loop, and if the n degree is 0, I'm pushing it in the queue. So we can start from those nodes which have no dependency. You can do those tasks which are not dependent on any other task. Okay, so you'll just push it, and then you will keep visited also as true, and you will increment the count because you have visited all these nodes. Okay. Now while the queue is not empty, this is a simple BFS based algorithm. So I'm running this algorithm while the queue is not empty. So I'm taking the first node, I'm popping it, and then I'm going to its neighbor. So this is just the adjacency list that I'm visiting. And now for each of the neighbors, so X is the neighbor, for each of the neighbor, So from the adjacency list, I'm getting the neighbors for each of the neighbors. If the neighbor is not visited before, right? So then what I'm going to do, I'm going to take its in degree and I'm going to make its in degree reduced by 1 because the dependency is reduced. If the in degree becomes 0, then in that case, I'm pushing it in the queue and I'm marking it as visited and I'm incrementing my count. Okay. Now, if my count is equal to the number of nodes, I will return 0. That means I have processed all the nodes. There is no cycle. But if there is a cycle, I'll return 1. So that is the simple algorithm. Now, in this case, let me just submit and see if it's working. So it's working. That's it. Thank you for being patient and listening.